Good morning. If you would please stand, turn in your hymn books to hymn number 434. This is our call to worship, and we'll sing verse 1 of Revive Us Again.
Good morning, and what a joy to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. Amen. It is good to be able to come and worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and we want to welcome you today. We've got a lot of people visiting today. Don, if I'd have known we'd have had this kind of response, I'd have invited you 5 years ago. But thank you, folks, for being with us today. I know we have a lot of visitors, and folks, be sure and welcome them before they leave today. It's always a joy to be in the house of the Lord, and we have been praying for this revival for months, and we're just praying for a moving of the Holy Spirit of God. That's what we need, amen? That's what our churches need. That's what our community needs. It's what our country needs, is just a touch of God so that God's people will come back together and worship Him in spirit and in truth. I only have one announcement, revival. 7 o'clock tonight, each evening, we just invite you to come and bring a friend. And as we worship today, I encourage our folks, worship from your heart because of the fact that you've been saved by the grace of God. And we ought to give Him everything that we have. Amen. So you pray and ask the Lord to speak to you today, to encourage you, to work in not only in your heart, but also in the lives of each person here, because God has something to say to each and every one of us. Amen? So welcome. Thanks for coming. Do I need to go ahead and introduce you now, Don? That way I won't have to do it in a little bit, okay? Most of you know Don Davidson. Don has been former pastor at Mount Hermon. He was there for 16 years and tremendous ministry there. He shared that he's only had 5 churches in his ministry. It started when he was 19 years old. And what a joy to have him and his wife with us today. We thank you for coming and sharing with us. And one of the things we have in common, he told me today, he said, my favorite pastor, preacher, was Adrian Rogers. I said, amen. He was my pastor for several years. And so, God bless him. What a tremendous ministry he had. Brother Don, in just a little bit, you come and you share with us. And as the Lord leads you, we're looking forward to great things because of the fact that He is here. Amen. So, where's Glenn at? Glenn, will you pray for us? I think you're... All right, good to see everyone again. If you would, please stand and turn in your hymn books to hymn number 323, At the Cross, and we'll sing verses 1, 2, 3, and 5.
Sacred and Lord, Savior.
morning. So while we're standing, if you will, please turn to hymn number 348, My Savior's Love. We'll sing verses 1, 2, 4, and 5.
May his messages be touching to someone and draw them closer to thee. Now, Father, we pray that you will take these tithes and offerings, continue to use them to glorify thy name. For us in thy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
this morning is hymn number 105, We Will Glorify, and we'll sing verses 1 and 4.
music. I've heard your pastor preach, and he does a great job, and you've got great music. I've known Colston's family for years, generations, actually, and it's good to see him and see how he's landed here, the job he's doing. But thank you for coming. I'm seeing a lot of old Mount Hermon friends. It's good to see you always. We had some wonderful times back in the day, and it's going to be good to reminisce if you're able to come back. And then we've got one of our friends from Alexandria who's come to share in the services. So thank you very much. I hope during these days I'll be able to say something that's encouraging to you, strengthening to you, and will point us all toward God. 3 days ago, I was staring down the face of lions and elephants. That we were, Audrey and I were on safari in South Africa and had a wonderful time. Then we flew home 24 hours in the air and arrived home in Richmond on Friday night. Usually when I am in a church I'm not familiar with, I pray the people will stay awake while I share. I've got a different prayer request today. I want to stay awake too. I'm severely jet lagged, but I'm going to stay awake, and you punch me if I begin to drift a little bit. I know everybody's busy, but I hope you'll come back every service, because these are important days and a lot's been invested in. You've been praying. People have been praying for God to work. So it's going to happen if you're here. So please come back. But if you can only come one service, you've already looked at your week, it's very crowded. If you can only come back once, come back tonight. Tonight's message is going to be very important. And I have something to say that I think is going to make a difference. So clear your calendar for tonight, be here, and we'll see what God does. Take a Bible, please, and turn to 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 4, and then a few verses in chapter 5. 1 Peter chapter 4, tucked away toward the end of the New Testament. The message is entitled this morning, "When I Find Myself in Times of Trouble." Can anybody relate to that? When I find myself in time of trouble. It's an old Beatles song. And the next line is, "When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom. Let it be, let it be." I always thought Mother Mary was the Virgin Mary, that he was talking about the Virgin Mary in the Catholic faith. But I heard him say that that was not it at all. His mother's name was Mary. And when he would be a teenager going through difficult times and wondering what's going to happen to his life, he'd be unable to sleep, his mother would come in and look at him and say, "Let it be. It'll be all right." Maybe you're going through a difficult time today. I know you must be. If you're not in trouble today, you're going to be next week, or you just came out of something. So I think it's going to be helpful today to share along those lines. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12. "Dear friends, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that has come to you to test you as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice inasmuch as you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when His glory is revealed. If you are insulted because of the name of Christ," does that ever happen to you? Are you insulted for the name of Christ? "You're blessed, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. If you suffer, it should not be as a murderer or thief or any other kind of criminal, or even as a meddler or busybody. However, if you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name. For it's possible for judgment to begin with God's." It's time for judgment to begin with God's household. "And if it begin with us, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if it's hard for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? So then, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good. Skip down to chapter 5, verse 6. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that He may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety, cast all your care on Him, because He cares for you. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for somebody to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of suffering. May the God of all grace, who called you to His eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will Himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To Him be the power forever and ever. Amen. Would you bow with me, please? Father, in these next few moments, we pray that You would speak to every heart and every life. People who came because they come every Sunday, those who rarely come, but they're here. You've arranged it all and opened their hearts and ears to receive Your truth. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. April the 12th, 1945. Vice President Harry Truman was back at the Capitol having a drink with his old congressional buddies at the end of the workday when he got summoned to the White House. He knew it must be serious. He raced through the halls of the Capitol building in a car and then to the White House. When he got there, they ushered him up to the second floor. He opened the door, and there was Eleanor Roosevelt. She said, "Harry, the president has died." Harry Truman said what you would probably say. He said, "Mrs. Roosevelt, is there anything I can do for you?" She said, "Harry, is there anything I can do for you? For you're the one in trouble now." He was unprepared to be president. He didn't know anything about the atomic bomb that he would make the decision to drop just a few weeks later. He had to learn it on the quick. He walked out of that meeting to the press and he said, "Guys, if you've ever prayed, pray for me now, for I see the moon and the stars and all the planets falling on me." When you find yourself in time of trouble, what do you do? Well, you'll never likely be in that situation where you're the leader of the free world making life and death decisions for millions. And you probably will never be in the place that Peter finds himself in. You know his story, the disciple of Jesus. In Acts chapter 4, he's called before the Sanhedrin and the temple police, and they rough him up a little bit, and they tell him he can't preach anymore in this name, but they finally let him go after making sure he understands they mean business. That's a fiery ordeal. It's never happened to you, but it happened to him. And then in Acts chapter 11, he is arrested. Acts chapter 12 goes on with the story. He's arrested. He's put in the inner prison between two guards and then other sentries at the door. And they're going to kill him the next day. For all he knows, that was the plan. It was going to be a quick show trial, but then he would be executed. You've never been in that kind of situation where you were about to die for your faith. He knows fiery ordeals. And yet, though that experience is not yours, you have suffered. I think about the people suffering through the storm that we've just endured. I was worried coming back that it would hit our place in Florida, but we escaped that. But the ravages of that storm came all over the eastern United States, and multitudes have died when I find myself in times of trouble. And you're all right now, but next week maybe you'll go to the doctor and he'll give you devastating news of something incurable. When you find yourself in time of trouble, what will you do? What will you do? Well, you've got to be prepared, and that's what I want to talk to you a little bit about this morning. First of all, you're going to react when the trouble comes. What's your initial reaction going to be? situations come suddenly. You're not looking for it to happen. It breaks in when you least expect it, like Jesus out on a storm-tossed sea. When they left one side, everything was peace and calm. When they got into the middle of the Sea of Galilee, all hell broke loose and this horrible storm, and they fear for their lives. They come suddenly. Suddenly. If you could see it coming afar, you might be better prepared, but you can't be prepared for everything. You can't be prepared for the struggles in family life and the struggles in the job market and how your career can be flourishing one day and then it's gone. What do you do? These things come suddenly. In November 1963, actor David Lodge was performing in a stage play in London's West End. And in the play, his character is supposed to be very nonchalant and very uncaring about things. And to show that, there's a point in the play when he cuts on a transistor radio, expecting to hear Chubby Checker and the Twist and all of that. It's just a moment, cut it on the radio and cut it off. But when he cut on the radio, it was November 22, 1963. And the news came over the radio that President Kennedy had just been assassinated in Dallas, Texas. He realized the commotion that would cause. He quickly tried to cut it off, but the word was out, and people began to run from the theater to deal with the situation in their own lives. It happened so quickly, suddenly. And it's surprising when it comes. Life is what happens to you while you're busy making other plans. And this is real life, suddenly, surprisingly. And often our reaction is one of self-pity. We ask, why me, Lord? Why did this have to happen to me? Well, I don't know that it had to happen, but it did happen. But we say, why? Why me? Well, I would ask, why not you? Why not me? The Bible says the rain comes on the just and the unjust. All God's people got problems. It's going to happen to you just like anybody else, because of our humanity and we're in the human condition. Nobody knows the troubles I've seen. Nobody knows but Jesus. Now we'll look for a reason. And maybe that's where you are right now. You're trying to figure out why this has happened. Often the troubles we face in life come by we bring it on ourselves. Peter says, if anybody suffers, it should not be as a murderer or a thief or any other kind of criminal or even as a busybody. Some of the times the suffering we go through, we brought it on ourselves. You break a law, you're going to go before the courts. You may go to jail. If you're unfaithful in your marriage, you may lose your marriage. Sometimes you can't put the thing together again. You made a choice. You murder somebody, you steal from somebody, you hurt somebody, you gossip about somebody. Those words can't come back, and then the troubles come. God's not doing it to you, you did it to yourself. Peter says, if you're going to suffer, you're going to suffer. Don't be surprised when you're suffering, but don't be the cause of it for yourself. Or it could be the attack of the adversary. The devil is real. I'm convinced of it. He's just as real as God is. And he's not in a red suit and carrying a pitchfork with horns on his head and a tail. He's very attractive. He's very, very persuasive. And we succumb to his temptations and we find ourselves in times of trouble. You brought it on yourself because of the attack of the evil one. What's he want to do? The scripture says he walks about as a roaring lion seeking somebody to devour. Lions will kill you. And the job of the lion is your destruction. He wants to destroy you. He wants to destroy your marriage. Because if he can destroy your marriage, then he's upset the trajectory of the lives of your children for a generation to come. He wants to destroy the church, and he's doing it all across the land today. Churches are struggling. I'm so encouraged by what I see here. The devil wants to destroy the church. It's not that the church is that important to him, and it's not that you're that important to him. He wants to devour you because of what the ripple effect will be through all society. And really what he wants to do, if you get down to it, he wants to hurt God. He wants to chip away at God again. And he knows God loves you, and he knows God loves this church. And so if he can do something to divide it, if he can do something to destroy it, if he can come between you and your spouse, I mean, we all have difficulties, we all have arguments, but if he can get in there and rip you apart, the damage goes on a long, long time to come. Often we bring it on ourselves. Sometimes it's the attack of the adversary, but it might just be God's will. What you're going through is God's will. So it's all right to ask him, why are you doing this, Lord? He is doing it. He's working his will to perform. Somebody said that a crisis is the invitation for a more intimate walk with God. He's working. He's drawing you to himself. He's getting your attention, forming his will in your life, making you stronger. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present world are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Romans 8, verse 18. So something bad happens, and you're trying to make sense of it. You didn't see it coming, but now it's here, and you're trying to figure out, and you may not get an answer to the question. If it's something you've done, you'll know it. But you can't always know the mind of God and what he's up to. But trust him. Trust him that he has a plan and that he has a purpose. Maybe the worst thing has happened. What could be the worst thing for you? The worst thing. Frederick Buechner says, with God, the worst thing is never the last thing. God's not finished. Yeah, you're going through it now, but God is at work, and he's going to bring you through that. So the question this morning is, how do we respond correctly? You're going to suffer. You're going to go through something. How do you respond correctly? Somebody once said to me that maturity is the ability to respond appropriately in any given situation. And that's why none of us is totally mature. We should be maturing. But if you can learn how to respond appropriately, you can get through this. Well, stay calm, certainly. Think back to Peter in Acts chapter 12. He's sitting there in prison. When Paul was in prison in Acts chapter 16, he and Silas were singing songs late into the night, and the prisoners were hearing them. In Acts chapter 12, Peter is in there by himself, between guards, they're at the door watching him. They're making jokes about how he's going to die the next day. And the scripture says he's calm. In fact, he goes to sleep. I don't know about you, but when I've got something on my mind that's bothering me, when I've got something big happening the next day and I'm not sure I'm ready for it, I have trouble sleeping. Peter didn't. He goes right to sleep. The angel came to deliver him and had to wake him up. Put on your clothes. We're going out of here. Stay calm. Psalm 4, chapter 4, verse 8 says, in peace I will lie down and sleep. So do these three things. Number one, rejoice. He says this back over in chapter 4, verse 13, but rejoice in so much as you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when His glory is revealed. Now, we don't think about that. That's not our first reaction. Woe is me is our first reaction. What am I going to do is my first reaction. He says, rejoice. Paul wrote in Philippians that when we shouldn't worry about anything, but in everything, in prayer and supplication, we should make our requests known unto God. And he says in chapter 4, rejoice. Again, I will say, rejoice. Happiness is your response to situations in your life. It's very surface oriented. We can be happy, we can be sad, but rejoicing or having joy in your life, that's a settled disposition. A thermometer tells you what the temperature is in the room. The thermostat sets the temperature that's in the room. And what I hear Peter saying is, let the thermostat for your life be joy. Rejoice. Rejoice. A dog falls down into a well, and they can't get him out. You know, there's no way to reach him. And so the wise farmer takes a shovel, and there's a pile of dirt, and he takes the shovel and pours a shovel full of dirt on the dog. And the dog presses it down. Then he sends another shovel load of dirt, and it covers his head, and the dog wiggles out of it and pats it down, and that happens several times, and every time he steps up until he's able to climb out of the well. So things happen. Rejoice in the midst of your suffering and make good use of it. Rejoice. The second thing is, be sure you're resisting the devil. If he is at work, if he's the one doing this, then learn how to resist him. Resist him. Your adversary, the devil, like a roaring lion, walks about seeking somebody to devour. Resist the devil. Stay alert. Watch out for his inroads. We did have the experience in Africa of walking with the lions, and I was kind of scared to do that, but they assured me it would be all right if I didn't turn my back on him. And so Audrey and I are walking, and our lovely guide, there was a group of us, our lovely guide explained, now we're going to go out there, and they were lion cubs. They weren't that big, but they had teeth, and they were functional, and they were jumping up and down. She said, now stay together as a group, because the lions look for the individual, they look for the stray, and they look for the oldest one in the group. And she looked right at me when she said it. That got my attention. And she said, now, you'll want to bend down and pet the animal, and that's okay, but be aware that it's their nature. When they're taking down another animal, they work together, and one is in front distracting you, and the other comes at you from behind. Well, we heard her, but late in the day, Audrey is leaning over. She sees this cute lion, and she's petting him, and suddenly the other lion from behind jumps on her back, and I bravely call for somebody to help her, and they got the lion off. But now, my point is, the best part of that experience was we were able to hold the littlest cubs and to feed them with baby bottles and hold them in our arm. And they're just so cute. And we could even put our hands in their mouths because they didn't have any teeth. And they're just gumming you. It was a beautiful experience. But our guide said, don't be fooled. Don't think you can make a pet out of this lion. Because their nature is to kill you, and they will if you let them grow up. Now, that's the way it is with the devil. That's the way it is with sin. You know, we get these little things. That it's not a big deal. It's I can quit any time. And we let it into our lives, and it grows up. And the devil has never changed his plan. He wants to devour you, and he'll use that thing that was so cute at first to be your ultimate destruction. So what's the proper response to trouble? Don't give the devil an opportunity. Resist the devil, James says, and he will flee from you. Resist him. Jesus would quote scripture to him, and that's probably the best thing any of us can do. You can't reason with the devil. He's smarter than we are, but you can give him scripture, and he has to eventually flee. Rejoice. Resist the devil. But now one more thing. Remain close to other believers. Remain close. That's what our guide was telling us in South Africa. Stay in a group. The elephants travel together in a group so that they can survive. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings. When you go through your darkest day, I hope you have got a church to surround you. I hope you're not just on the names, not just on the roll. I hope and pray that you have a relationship of strength and camaraderie that gets through that darkest time. Everybody's got their problems. One day you'll be up and you'll be encouraging those around you who are sad. The next day it'll be you that's having difficulty and sadness and perplexity in your life, and the church will come around you. But woe to the person who doesn't have a church. One of my friends back at Mount Hermon, it was my privilege to lead him to faith in Christ, but he was ready for it when I was talking to him, because he had had a relative, a brother, just die. And they were going through that experience as a family. And they were meeting at the funeral home, planning the arrangements. And the funeral director said, "Now, who's your pastor?" And he thought to himself, "I don't have one. I don't have a church." And he was suddenly looking for one. Be together. When trouble comes, we have a tendency to do one of two things. We either draw closer to the church, closer to friends and believers, or we pull away. We're embarrassed because it's something we brought on ourselves, or it shouldn't have happened, but it did, and we're embarrassed, and we're very private people, and we pull away. Don't do that. Draw the ever closer. The best illustration of this, I tell this story often. It so impacted my life. I was doing a funeral in our Alexandria church, in our chapel. It was an elderly lady, and she was a godly woman. We were planning her service, and her 20-something, I guess she was about 20 years of age, her 20-year-old granddaughter wanted to sing. And I don't recommend that. It's hard enough speaking at a loved one's funeral, but to sing, I mean, you can't, you got to go on with the song. So I don't recommend it, but when they insist, what can a preacher do? You know, you let them do it. So I said, okay, and we came to the service, and I didn't know she had a small child, that she didn't have anybody to watch it, so she brought the little child up in her arms, and she's standing behind the pulpit holding a baby in one hand, and she's singing, and she sang, "His eye is on the sparrow." You know that song? "His eye is on the sparrow. Why should I be discouraged? Why should the shadows come? His eye is on the sparrow. I know he watches me." And she did okay. She did a pretty good job until she got to the chorus. You know the chorus? "I sing because I'm happy." And she began to cry. She just dissolved in tears right in front of us. And I felt sorry for her, but, you know, she's in the middle of the song. What an amazing thing happened. The pianist continued to play, and the congregation picked up the chorus and finished the song until she could get herself together enough to join us again. Now that's what happens. Sometimes you lose the song. Sometimes you lose the melody. You forget the words. The church can keep it going until you can get back into it. When I find myself in times of trouble, that's when I need God more than ever. That's when you will need Him more than ever. But remember, no matter what, the worst thing, it's not the last thing with God. He's going to bring you through if you lean on Him and trust in Him. Would you pray with me, please? In just a moment, we're going to sing, I Surrender All, and your pastor is going to stand here at the front. And maybe today God has spoken to you. Maybe you're going through something. And you need to rely on Him and lean on Him. And so you can come and the pastor will pray with you. Maybe you're making another kind of decision to get serious with God for the first time or the first time in a long time. You come and tell Him. There's something about coming forward that seals it. It makes it more real if you act on what you're feeling right now. So I pray you will. Father, may your will be done in this place. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Let's stand.
Such a blessing to know that when we go through times of trouble, He's with us. I don't know about you, but I'm walking through some times and I need Him. And what a joy to know that there's people we can count on when we walk through the valley. when we walk through those times. And so what an encouragement to hear from the Word of God, to know that He walks with us. So I want to encourage you today. There's not anybody in here that doesn't have any troubles. But you know what? We can come to Him. And what a joy to be able to do that. I'm looking forward to what God's going to do this week. We're just starting, and matter of fact, you said you wanted to come for the music tonight. We have somebody singing, you may know, Lori Taylor. She's going to be singing with us tonight, and so we got special music each service, so let me encourage you to invite somebody and bring them with you. I mean, the best place you can be is right here. Amen? So let me encourage you. Don, thank you so much for that message. Man, you encouraged my heart today. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I've got a couple prayer requests before we dismiss. So let me share these with you very quickly. Judy, is it Donovan? Is that correct? You put that on here. Remember her? Gertrude Hundley, she was a member of my last church and Kate's sister. So if you will remember her, family of Bobby Riddle, and then the family of Fred Lee Moore. If you will remember these, please. Anyone else before we pray this morning? Behave yourself. She's having a problem with breathing, so please pray for Sally, okay? Okay, let's pray together. And once again, thank you for coming today. And people, if you will look around and please welcome our visitors before they leave, okay? Father, thank you so much for the joy of being in your house today. And Father, for the message that we've heard, what a just timely message. Because Father, we're in a time of trouble right now. And Father, we thank you for the encouragement from the Word of God. Father, continue to minister to each and every one. Lord, you've heard these requests. Pray especially for Sally, that you'll encourage her, that she'll be able to breathe better. And Father, all these other requests, Lord, we just bring them before you today. Thank you for each person that's here. Thank you for our visitors. What a joy, once again, to be in the house of the Lord. Father, we ask these things now in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen.